everybody, hope you're doing marvellously well. Sitting here once again with my friend Bradley Cook.
Hello.
Great. Now, those of you that follow me will know when I interviewed Bradley, I got a little starstruck because one of the most important records for me of the 90s, and one of the most important records full stop, is Recovering Satellites by The Counting Crows. It was a model for me for several albums, one of which being both The Fray's first and second record, but also Augustana's second record. And we love so much about it, so much that we just went and listened to some of The Fray's first and second record, and you heard some of the same drum ideas and same piano stuff and some of the guitar. I mean, we all loved it. The band loved it. We loved it. Those guys making the records. And it was a reference. So we don't have multi-tracks to go through, but what we do have is the album we can play back and talk about. So let's
jog the old memory.
Jog the memory.
Yeah.
So first of all, where was it recorded?
It was recorded in a big house, a big mansion place. You know where the Mayfair Market is on Franklin over
sure.
here in Hollywood?
Yep.
Just up the street, up the hill, there was a big, huge house called Artemisia, is what they called it. It's like it was the first house on the hill over there.
Great.
Owned by a congressman.
Oh, wow.
And has a big pipe organ built into the walls and stuff. And
wow.
Big, huge foyer for the drums. And it was really neat. Big, massive kitchen. And
so you did the drums in an entrance foyer or like
mm-hmm.
a...
That's nice. Right. I guess they had rented a house for the previous one as well. So by the time they got to the second one, they thought they should pay for the record themselves. I think they paid for it themselves, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
But they bought a whole like recording package. And they said, you know, what stuff do you want to use for the record? So I got to put my dream list of stuff together.
Sure.
Like Charlie Bolas came and commissioned a new 827.
Nice.
Studio 827 and got to pick all the outboard gear and mic pre's and later on, you know, Dave says, "You want anything else you might need?" It's like, "How about a rack of API stuff?"
Right.
And a big old rack of API stuff appeared, so it was super, super dreamy.
Was there a console? Was it just all outboard pre's?
It was all outboard pre's, and we listened back on like some Soundcraft board or whatever they had, so just like a monitor board from back from a tape machine.
Oh, wow.
So there was Pro Tools involved, but it was pretty early. It was Pro Tools 3, so it was just good enough to use for maybe bouncing some stuff and some utility stuff, but the record lived on lots of tape.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
That's amazing. I want to go through song by song and see if I can jog the memory. Catapult's the first song, which I think is an amazing opening for any record. First of all, is that a real Mellotron?
It is a real Mellotron. I don't think there were fake Mellotrons around at that time. We had to use the real thing.
And so was it rented and then
I don't know if they owned it or I don't think it was a rental situation. I think they own all their stuff.
Because we were just talking about the keyboard player earlier.
Charlie.
Just a great guy.
He's great.
Is it stereo mic'd amp?
Yeah, it was probably two deluxes.
All of a sudden, the tremolo one,
just yesterday, she was here. Somebody tell
drums from drummer's perspective.
The cuts into my
I hear the floor over there.
And I want to be scattered from here in this catapult. What a big baby. Won't somebody save me, please? Won't find nobody home.
See, why this album to me is such a great album is it sounds like a band that is uniquely American. It's Americana to me. It's like comes from roots, sounds like an American band. But the pedal and the parts, the sound over there, sounds like they just listened to the bends by Radiohead. You know what I mean? It's about that time, or Modern Life is Rubbish by Blur. Like, there's some experimental guitar tones inside of a rootsy rock Americana album. So for me, it sort of clicked, it ticks all the boxes of the period. Like, you know, what was great about American music and stealing what was great about British current band.
That's great.
It's got a way over there so it doesn't compete with Adam's vocal.
Yeah. You know. Do you remember what amp he was using?
Deluxes.
Deluxes?
Yeah, two Deluxes. Yeah.
That's amazing.
Just a little tiny.
And do you use one mic or two of them? How do we mic
two,
it?
Yeah.
Two?
Probably 87s.
87s?
I think so. Sam Vickery.
Great guitar playing, just super guttural and like, you know, like impulsive and yeah. So it brings a real rock energy to something, you know. You know, you think of the Counting Crows, people, most people would think of them as being a very polite band, you know.
They can rock.
Yeah, but they can rock, yeah. And Adam wasn't like 12, was he? He was like a little older, you know what I mean? He'd made records, he'd lived a life, you know, as well. I think there's also some attitude in that, you know what I mean?
He's a real artist.
Yeah, he's a real artist. So the drums are in the entrance foyer. What are you doing mic-wise on the drums?
The M582s that we use, I ended up buying from them.
Oh, you did?
So those M582s, yeah. Probably still all standard kind of stuff. I mean, this is only the second record I ever did, you know? So
right.
Probably all that standard stuff, you know, just 57s and 421s or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Fret 47, all standard kind of mic.
And you, again, the 421 inside the kick?
Probably, yeah. That might have been D12 or something like that as
right.
well, because we had a lot more mics to choose from.
And what about room mics?
U69.
Oh, wow.
Wow. U69 flying way up high in the foyer. Like, you'd enter the house and there was stairs that went up to the bedrooms and then stairs that went down to the ballroom. It was like a huge ballroom downstairs.
Wow.
Like, in the morning, I'd go roll a DAT machine upstairs, run downstairs and break broken tubes.
Yeah.
Slam doors.
Wow.
It's a big room effects and stuff.
Did you use them anywhere on the record?
No, just for fun.
You just wanted
my
to
sound library. You know?
Wow.
Yeah.
What is the house still there?
It has to be, yeah.
It has to be. I wonder who has it. It might be rented out for parties and stuff like that. It sounds like one of those kind of
it's
places.
It's like a big old 20s kind of house, very 20s,
right.
You know.
Classic old
styling.
Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
And then for bass, was it... B15.
B15, yeah.
Do you remember what you would have mic'd that with?
Probably a FET 47.
And are you blending in DIs with this, or are you just going straight with amps?
Well, back then, there was no guitar DIs back then, but certainly there was a bass DI.
Right, okay.
There was just not enough tracks to warrant that kind of thing.
Sure.
You know, it's like postponing decisions as well.
Right.
And get our tone and do it.
Yeah.
You know.
Fantastic. All right, I'm going to play Angels of Silence. Again,
I think mainly deluxe on the whole record. Yeah.
I love the drive on that guitar. Even though it's eighth notes, it doesn't fold into itself. It's still got some solidity. Fantastic. Leslie?
Yeah, and it's, you know, bolstered up underneath the guitars, it makes the guitar sound huge.
Yeah.
You know that
Cracker
song, I Hate My Generation?
Yeah, yeah.
That's Charlie on the Hammond.
Oh, it is?
Mm-hmm. I didn't know that. Hear those super heavy guitars and the Hammonds underneath it. This makes guitars sound like muscles.
That's fantastic. Are you? What are you using on a Leslie? What do you typically like?
If I'm producing it, I don't like the old spinny back and forth thing. I'll do like one side.
Yeah.
It's just one side of it.
Right.
I want half the spins. I want a homogenous organ I can put anywhere in the track.
Oh, I see.
I don't feel the need to do this.
I see.
Depending on the, like even pianos, like if it's a rock track, I don't do piano low and piano high.
Yeah.
I'll do a mono picture of it.
Sure.
Like a static below and mono picture, and then I can put that anywhere I want in the pan.
Interesting. This would have been stereo, do you remember?
This is stereo, yeah, for sure.
So maybe RE20s on the top or 57s?
Probably 421s.
Probably 421s.
Yeah. Believe that.
So wait there, I think you're to blame why everybody used 421s. All right, I'm going to go to Daylight Fading, which is, I mean, that last song, Angels of Silence, is such a, or Angels of the Silences, I should say, such a great rocker. But Daylight Fading, this is a beautiful song.
Oh, yeah.
So you have an interesting story about this.
It took us a while to get the drums on this one, to have the pocket just play as needed. So we spent probably 6 or 7 Sundays, every Sunday, trying to get this groove.
So like every time you thought you had a day off, you were working on Daylight Fading. Yeah.
It's a groundhog day. We got it, you know.
So everything remains set up. You got in, you went into the studio, you set up all the mics.
And their construction guy, whose name I forgot, he made these like dog houses, we're calling, for amps.
Right.
Like amp ISOs, and he put plexiglass on either side of the window so it wouldn't bother the neighbors. And in between, you know, there was like a entrance foyer and a carpeted living room here where the control room was, kitchen behind it. And in this way, it was a big shoebox shaped room, which we had all the keyboard world and guitar world and vocal world in there. It was a pretty small space, actually.
Right.
A big dead space and then a big live, foyer space for the drums.
Right.
Pretty small, really. And everyone just stayed there in the bedrooms, the residential.
And you have a couple of photos from the from that session.
I do. So this is like me sit with all the stuff behind me. Me looking like an idiot with the stuff behind me.
You got some hair here.
Yeah.
There's some hairage going on. There's some rock days there.
Yeah.
I like it though with the very LA kind of top, but the long hair.
About that Elvis thing, me and my girlfriend went to Graceland, brought that 60s Elvis shirt or something.
A 60s Elvis shirt. Very nice. All right, so we're going to move now on to what I think is the masterpiece on the record. And this is a record full of amazing songs. And that's I'm Not Sleeping, which has the orchestral arrangement done by Mr. Paul Buckmaster, who sadly died just over a year ago. But this song is...
Number 4 in the sequence, too.
Yeah, number 4.
Wow.
Strings.
She comes to me at night when I'm sleeping. She comes to me when I'm alone. Comes to me, she holds my hand when I'm crying.
I love that vocal. It's so dry and warm and up in your face. Do you remember what Micah did this?
Probably a 47.
I would have gone with 47 if you'd asked me, yeah.
It's also a carpeted room. It's dead as dead in there.
Yeah.
Super dead. Zero any kind of reflections.
So it's in the house. They had a carpeted room in the house.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Yeah. In the middle of the carpeted shoebox. Shoebox room. And this is the one where he woke me up in the middle of the night to come sing.
Yeah.
I told him, you know, if you ever, because he was not sleeping at night and stuff, I said, if you ever have an inspiration, come wake me up. We were all just sleeping there.
Yeah.
So he like, hey. He woke me up and we did the vocal at night. It was really cool.
He's not sleeping and the song's called
I'm
Not Sleeping.
I remember he's like yelling it at the end, like, what are anybody's hearing?
Yeah.
I was so quiet in the house.
What time, like early in the morning?
3 in the morning.
Oh, nice. How many vocal takes? Because we're on tape, how many?
I think just maybe three takes.
And then just calm from the three takes?
Yeah, so I told you, hey man, got some vocals for sleeping last night. Oh, great. We just went through and calmed them.
Nice.
Yeah. Sincere performance, so we didn't need many of them, you know?
Right. Sanity between the guitars and the strings is so good. So it's convenient. It's completely different. I love it. Drums are amazing too.
You can hear that for you.
Yeah. But then almost like a Ray Manzarek kind of like piano part there, like a nice and... Like I say, to me, it's like, it's that perfect blend of what I like mid-90s about American music, stealing a lot of British things as well, and putting the two things together. It's really, really great. Michael's so dry.
Here's the dry bit, exactly.
I'll follow you down, baby, down into the valley.
And his voice, so good.
Up again, but I'm not sleeping anymore. No, I'm not sleeping anymore.
Ah.
And there's a part that comes up where he's jumping up and down. You can hear his body moving.
He's like, no.
I was looking through the window and he's jumping up and down. I'm like, he's going for it.
Fantastic. B bender?
Set one? Elizabeth?
Elizabeth, yeah. Good night, Elizabeth. The B bender on the guitar.
Tell me what the B bender is.
I don't know, yeah.
The bass.
So good. Is that small body acoustic? Know what it is?
I can't remember.
It's just the perfect size acoustic
guitar.
Guitar
or something. Yeah.
Yeah. What do you use on acoustics?
I mean, Shep's 221Bs, a 545,
right.
Beyer 160.
Beyer 160 is right.
It depends how shiny it needs to be or how round it needs to be.
This is a great acoustic sound.
I can't remember what this was.
Well, I wish you were inside of me.
What are you doing? I mean, compression-wise, are you pretty gentle on it going in?
Yeah. I mean, I don't think I'm compressing drums much. It's just like maybe keyboards and certainly vocals and stuff and bass.
Do you know what you use with Adam's vocal? Just chain wise after a 47?
Probably an LA2, making 160 LA2 at my old trick. You know.
Yeah, nice.
I went for Distressor and then.
Sure.
And, but I think that 160 is actually better. Come back to that.
I do love the 160 in the vocal.
I want to keep it kind of open. I don't want to overdo any compression, you know?
Right.
We could not be cowboys. Some of us are clowns.
And I think that reverb's real. That's from the, we just opened the doors and there was that entire foyer with stairs that went up, and I had a microphone way up in the top of the stairwell. That's all just real stuff.
What piano was it? Is it upright you brought in, or was there a grand piano?
It was a baby grand.
Baby grand. Love a friend as well. Very strong rumors that this song is about Courtney Cox. All right, next up is Children in Blue. Another crazy one.
What is this one? Children
in Blue.
Oh, yeah, God. Well, I haven't heard this.
Such a well-constructed song. Such a well, the way, like, you know, just everything.
The Hammond
the
swells.
The Hammond swells. That groove on the bone, down, 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 that bass just rolls around on itself. Such an amazing line. This is like a real band. It feels like guys in the room who are rehearsing and playing with each other and just getting it so it feels good. Doesn't sound like a bunch of overdubs.
And Gil is writing it with him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Bass line.
Matt Malley.
Gotta get out of the sunlight. So good. In my bones. Gotta get up from the slumber. Just get myself home.
Oh, Tom's.
So, for all of our joking about 421s, they pick up Tom's pretty well.
Are you
going back to 421s after this?
I just gotta work too hard at it. The drums sound great.
Yeah.
But I really haven't heard this for 22 years or whatever.
That's amazing.
I can remember all the lyrics as it flows. I can remember the lyrics. It's like, oh yeah.
No, it's to me, it's a perfect example of what I loved about, you know, American music at this period, because it's got all, and I keep saying it, but it's got a bit of everything in it. There's a bit of frickin' rock in there, like
Beatles.
Yeah, there's some Beatles in there, and there's a ton of Americana. And of course, you got Adam's insanely good voice. And the songwriting. It hasn't been a bad song yet. How many albums have this many potential singles on it these days? Like
how
zero.
How many singles were on this thing?
Yeah. Daylight Fading was kind of a single, but I know Goodnight Elizabeth was a big hit.
Really?
And of course, Long December, well, sort of. Long December was a huge hit.
That's
sure
the one from this record, probably.
Yeah.
Long December.
Yeah. Well, let's flick up to that and have a listen.
Mm-hmm. December, and there's reason to believe maybe this year will be better than the last. I can't remember the last thing that you said as you were leaving, but the days go by so fast, and it's one more day up in the canyon.
So he used to live at the bottom of my street. I don't know if you ever went to his house.
Sure, yeah.
But you can drive past it. He was living in, I believe it was Christina Applegate's house at the
time.
That's
right.
And he was renting it from her.
That's right.
Just as you come up the street,
yeah,
up here. And so whenever he would sing about that, this house that I bought was my friend Chad Fisher's. And so he would have parties here, and musicians would come around, and sometimes he'd be here, and you know, Dan Rothschild, Jeff Trott, or who else? The guy from Caviar that died, Kevin. Crazy. People would come up here and jam. It was just like, those were the days.
Golden days.
So I always wanted to like live in the canyon. Yeah, singing songs about the canyon. I want to live in the canyon. So I live in the canyon.
I was driving up here, I thought, it's so beautiful, it's all green and stuff. I haven't been in the canyon for a while.
It's amazing.
It's really nice here.
Amazing. Well, thank you, everybody. Hope you enjoyed that. Bradley, you rock. Once again, please leave any comments and questions below, and we'll see if we can throw young Bradley under the bus.
I'm sure I've forgotten something.
Yes. And there's probably some little tidbits that you may have read about, you know, maybe from Adam and stuff. I will say before we go, Adam used to bartend down the Viper Room in the mid late 90s. So we used to play shows there, and he was the bartender.
Yeah.
It was pretty crazy. Yeah.
Man about town.
Man about town. Wonder if anybody has any Adam stories. I've got a couple of others, but we'll leave those for another time. All right. Thanks ever so much. Thanks. All right.